My parents were farmers like me. From the time I was born, I watched my parents farming, and now I'm doing what they did. It's like an inheritance from them. Eight kids and nine grandkids. I could only afford to send some of my kids to school, while some of them had to stay home. Sometimes my children didn't have enough to eat. It made me very sad, but I couldn't do anything about it. So I prayed, and God sent people my way to help. Convoy of Hope's agronomists provided training on how to plant our seed. With the first harvest of Convoy's seeds, I harvested a greater yield than ever before. With the seed and training Convoy gave me, I am able to get more money for my crops. The program has made a big difference in my life. I used to struggle to feed my family. Now, I can feed my children more, and they are healthier. Some of my children have already started farming with me. I am happy because I can pass down the techniques I have learned from Convoy of Hope to them.
It's a very appropriate offering that we're receiving for One Day to Feed the World, especially the Sunday before Thanksgiving. So many of us want to do more to help people. This is something that's helping folks, especially during COVID, all around the world. And next week, we're going to be talking a little bit more, sharing a little bit more about what specifically and how specifically Convoy comes alongside and helps with that. So pray over that. Bring your offering next week. Today, we're going to bring the Pierce family up here in just a minute and pray over them and bless them. We have talked about their journey and what God has been doing through them. Brandon joined our team in 2020, in the first quarter, second quarter of 2020, and it helped us rebuild and just really get new systems together for our technology and for our videoing and all of our tech capabilities. He's been, the team has just rallied around him, and they love him so much. And Angela joined our team in December of last year as our youth pastor. And it wasn't but a few months after that that they came to me and said, listen, we've got a confession. God's called us to plant a church in Kannapolis. And so we have been partnering with them and walking the journey with them, and we're so excited to push them into what God has called them to do. But as a church, I want us to lay our hands on them. I want us to pray for them. I want us to bless them. And then following that, Angela is going to be sharing a story and a sermon around hope for the outcasts, sharing her own testimony as a part of that story. Because in this series that we have, this whole Won't You Be My Neighbor, it's really all about this love of Jesus. So if I could get Brandon and Angela and their kids to come up, and then if we could get the, yeah, come on up, guys, come on up. And then if we could get the, y'all come up here front and center. And then if we could get the teenagers and the youth ministry, if I could get staff and board and spouses, come on up around them. And we're going to lay our hands on them and pray. We, like I said, we've talked about this, about God's calling on their life. And as a church, man, we're excited. One day, some of you may be called to plant a church. Or you may be called to the mission field in a specific way. And this church is going to rally around you. We're going to lay our hands on you. We're going to commission you. We're going to support you. We're going to pray God's best in your life. Because the people that make up this church, they're all His. The people that make up this church, they're all His. There you go. This isn't your church. It ain't my church. It's His church. So we're going to lay our hands and we're going to bless them. We welcomed Pastor Bo and his family last week. Now Pastor Bo and his family are laying their hands on them as we send them out. They're going to be working full-time to plant this church in Kannapolis, Restoration City Church. And I got a couple of things I want to pray specifically over y'all. Pastoring is not an advancement or a career choice. It's a holy vocation. And the congregation that God puts under you, that is fertile soil for what He's going to do in you. The congregation that you serve will change your life more than you realize. And in that way, I would say humility is better equipment for you than ambition. Expect the seeds that you plant to die, because the God of resurrection will lead the way. And again, God is doing more in you in these first years than He's going to do through you. See, we go into ministry sometimes and we think that God wants to build His church and we get to be the people that He uses. There's some truth to that. But all I've really learned in ministry is that God's trying to make a man out of me. God's trying to make a follower out of me. And His church is my church. Not that I own it, but I do walk out front as the leader and as the pastor. But this church builds my life as I serve it. And the last thing, because I couldn't remember everything. Pray God's blessing over you. So with your hands stretched out forward, let's pray over them. God, I pray over Brandon, and I pray over Angela. Father God, I pray your protection over them. Going out and planting a church, there is so much that we don't know. So God, this really is, in many ways, a step of faith. Walking into the unknown. God, I pray for this family. I pray that you would protect them. I pray that you would guard their minds and guard their hearts. In the name of Jesus, we speak blessing over them and life over them. And we look at Kannapolis and we look at what you're going to do through this family. And we rejoice. And when the tears come, we will partner with them and we will cry with them. Because anytime we think that the church is perfect, we are quickly reminded that it is led by imperfect people. So, Father God, I pray, give them not only your wisdom, give them discernment and favor, Father God. And as you dig around their hearts, keep them open to you. Keep them open to what you're doing. I pray that you would slow down the feelings and the pressures that we so quickly place in front of us. And we thank you, God. We thank you that we get to be the church that sends them out. And with excitement, we say, go get them. With anticipation, we say, hey, here's some stuff to help. And with humility, we say, oh God, this is your church. And we pray God's kingdom would come. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Could you just show your love to Brandon and Angela and their kids? Yeah, isn't this awesome? Y'all can have a seat. Angela, you stay up here because you got to preach. She was like, so how am I going to preach after you pray? What if I'm crying and all this stuff? I was like, well, you've got to work through it because that's what pastors do. So Angela's going to bring a word today. I want y'all to lean in and who knows what will happen next. Actually, I do. I got a picture I want to share. This past week, I took a selfie with Angela. And I can't tell you, when she gets a microphone sometimes, I have no idea what's going to happen. And especially today, since it's your last Sunday, please don't say anything that I'm going to regret.
Okay.
Okay, thanks.
I'll try not to.
Because we've given her a microphone again, and thank you for not wearing that hat. And if you look at my face there, that's called fear. That's what that is. She's one of the most unique individuals that I've ever met in my life. Gosh, we were in Kenya about 20 years, almost 20 years ago now, when God was doing some things in her life. And what Shauna and I saw was a person just emerging into a minister. Like we got to see the first parts, or at least for us, some of the first parts of your transformation from being just a person saved by Jesus, like moving into a servant of Jesus. And I almost showed that picture, but because of your dignity, I decided not to.
Thank you.
But give it up for Angela. She's going to bring God's word. Amen.
I'm going to try because, like, I'm already crying listening to him talk and remind me of those memories. But we are excited. We are so excited. We have all the emotions. Can you guys, you know, you have like sadness and excitement go hand in hand. So like, I'm super sad. I can't even look at you guys right now because I'll just cry. Like these are my babies right here, and whoever's not sitting on the front row because they're too cool. I see you. But I love all of them, and so we are excited though to be planting Restoration City. And today, I'm really going to share with you guys what I feel is really the heart of Restoration City. So like he said, we're planting Restoration City. I love what Pastor said last week. There is a difference between relief and restoration. And we're going to do relief. Relief is good, okay? We didn't say relief is bad. Relief is a great thing. In the time of need, you come in. But what I feel like we lack a lot of times is the true restoration that something takes. And a lot of times, restoration takes a long time. I'm living proof of that. God's still working on me. So it takes a long time. So at Restoration City, we're focusing a lot of what we do on the restoration part. But guys, it gets messy. It gets dirty. It gets, because when you get real and raw, listen, you show up on a Sunday, we all look pretty and we all wear our best clothes. I chose to wear this today. You wear your best clothes and you look nice and you know, whatever, and you come in, but a lot of us have a lot of stuff. A lot of us, yes, it's okay to admit, we all have a lot of stuff. And so when you start digging in that stuff, that's when it gets messy and it gets dirty. But guys, my heart is that restoration takes place. The unsaved, but also us saved people. So that's what our church is about. And I want to show you a video of something we did. This was Halloween. Take a look at this video. Is basically I was dressed up like an old lady. It was awesome. I'm really fun, guys. If you ask my youth kids, my kids are like, oh wow, mom. I'm super fun. I am silly. So we dressed up and we went and passed out candy. So what we have done at Restoration City is we have adopted essentially a government housing apartment complex. So we have committed to them for the next 5 years. So at least for the next 5 years, we are going to pour into it. So we're not just going to go in and say, here's some relief. We are going to go in and build relationships with these families, come alongside of them, and really restore them. I mean, our goal is to get them out of public housing and jobs. And I mean, we have all these dreams for them. So anyways, So we have adopted this community, and so what you saw there is we were literally just, we dressed up and we knocked on their door and we gave candy to them. And it was so funny because a lot of them were like trying to give us candy, and I was like, no. And it was funny because we were all adults and they still were going to give us candy. I was like, you guys are the best. Like, there's no children. It was just all of us adults dressed up, and they still were just good. They're the best people. Listen, they were the best people. But I want to be honest with you guys. We're talking about loving the outcast today. And some people would think they're the outcast of our society. And so let's start by defining what outcast means. Outcast is a person who has been rejected by society or a social group. How many of you guys have ever felt rejected? Raise your hand. If your hand's not up, you're telling a lie. Every single person in this room has walked into a situation and you felt like you didn't belong. You felt like you weren't part of the group, you weren't part of the inner circle, those people don't like me. For whatever reason, you felt like an outcast. We've all been there at some point of our life where we've come in and you're like, wow, I don't fit in here at all. Now, could you imagine that feeling? Everyone think of that feeling that you felt. We all can think it. Could you imagine feeling like that every single day of your life? Every moment, unworthy, unloved, not good enough. Could you imagine every day waking up thinking that this is how a social group thinks of me? This is how society thinks of me. Could you imagine every day of your life feeling that way? Well, these are how some people in our community feel every day. Every day. And so today I'm going to challenge all of us. Well, how can we love on them? How can we show them that they aren't that? Because the reality is they aren't that. They're not. Things have said they were that, but they're children of God. They aren't outcast. And I am hopefully going to show you guys today how we can, as a church, begin to show them you're not an outcast. You're one of us. You are loved. You are worthy. You do have great things in store. So let's dig in today. So loving the outcast. So I want to start by looking at Jesus, because you guys, I could sit up here and say all my ideas, but what did Jesus say about loving the outcast? If we're Christ followers, what did Christ say? So I love when we really look at the attributes of Jesus, we discover about him regarding the outcast is that he views the outcast to still be a part of the community that he lives in. He doesn't view them as outcast. Actually, he proves this over and over again by associating himself with them. He did it all the time. And on many occasions, it didn't matter what the other people thought of their sins. He just loved them. And so let's look at some scriptures today, because as we look at the scriptures, we're going to see that Jesus literally broke religious laws loving the outcast. He literally broke, and I love, where's Michaela? She did not even know the Holy Spirit was going to work today, because it's literally what I'm talking about today, about breaking these religious things that we have somehow. It's not even of God a lot of times, these things, and we have worked it. Those things have to come down. Jesus broke a lot of those religious laws. He was like, no more, people. So let's look at some stories. So in John 9, this is where Jesus healed the blind man. And most of you would be like, yes, that's great. But when did he heal the blind man? On the Sabbath. So according to the rituals and the rules, he had done wrong by messing with the clay, by working and healing on the Sabbath. Could you imagine anybody in need and we literally walk by and we're like, today I'm resting today. It's my day. Those were rules and laws. But Jesus was like, I really don't care. This man's in need. I'm going to heal him. Okay, let's talk about the leper. This is in Luke 5, and I'm not going to read these scriptures, but you guys can go back and read these stories. If you don't know these stories, and I'm not assuming all of you do, if you did not grow up in church like me, I encourage you, jot this down, read these stories. They're amazing stories of how God really loved the outcast. So let's talk about the leper. So give you some backstory on the leper. A leper was someone that literally was an outcast. So a lot of times they lived outside of the camp. When they walked by, they had to yell, unclean! Could you imagine being such an outcast that when you come in somewhere, you literally had to yell out, unclean? No one touched them. No one was around them. They literally had to yell out to make sure they stayed an outcast. And what did Jesus do? There was so, it made him ritually unclean. That was, you considered. He literally reached out and touched him. That person might not have been touched for years. And Jesus is like, he saw a need and he's like, I'm just gonna do what I need to do. And I love the story of the leper though, guys, because the leper was really someone that most people, and it wasn't like, we consider someone an outcast. No, the leper was truly an outcast. Like, they were not. No, you need to stay away. You really. And I hate to say it. I feel like a lot of times we do treat people that way. For whatever reason. They might think differently, act differently, look differently, smell differently. I don't know. But Jesus was like, I don't care if I'm going to be unclean. I'm going to touch this man and I'm going to do what he needs. So here's another story. In John 4, this is the Samaritan woman. And this is where Jesus had come to the well. The woman had her own set of, she was already an outcast. She had all the men and we know the story. And Jesus, what did he do? Outside of not even supposed to be talking to her because she's a Samaritan, he sat down. He talked to her. He gave her hope. And what did she do? She went and told everyone. Guys, Jesus broke a lot of the religious laws at the time to do his ministry, to do God's will. See, guys, when Jesus reaches out to the outcast, he treats them like family. He doesn't treat them any different. It's not like he looks at someone and says, yep, I understand. You need to just, he treats them like family. And how do we treat family? Don't answer that. Some of you are like, not good. How are we supposed to treat family, right? So let's share this story of the tax collector. If you've grown up in church, you've heard this story. But if you haven't, let me give you some backstory. So tax collectors in the day, they were basically sent out by the Romans and they took the taxes. But a lot of times what happened is these tax collectors would take a cut for themselves. And a lot of times it was a big cut for themselves. And so they were hated by the people. If you were a tax collector, you were considered a crook. They did not like you. They wanted you, you were deceitful, all the things you can think of. Because they would literally take people's money that wasn't even supposed to be took. And so I love this story. Levi is one of the tax collectors, also known as Matthew in the other Gospels. And so Jesus finds him sitting at the tax collector booth. So here's Levi sitting at the tax collector booth. And what did he say to Levi? Anybody. This is, you can talk back. It's fine. Yes. Thank you. He literally looks at Levi and says, leave everything behind and follow me. And you're like, wow, that's not really. Listen, follow me back in the day were words that were only uttered a lot of times. The rabbis would say, follow me, usually after a long, lengthy process. So normally the rabbis would go through, you know, an interview process to see if you were even good enough to be a disciple. And then normally they had a slew of people, like hundreds of people, to decide, you know, who's going to be a disciple. And then after going through this lengthy process and even having multiple people to choose from, they didn't just utter follow me lightly. It was normally a huge deal for them to say, follow me. You are deemed worthy to follow me. But Levi is literally sitting in the tax collector booth, and Jesus deems him worthy when nobody else does. In the middle of probably taking up taxes. And he says, come and follow me. He leaves everything, he goes. And what do? They throw a party, right? They go back to his house. They invite all of the friends over. They're sitting there, they're eating. What do you usually have a meal with? Your family. Here's Jesus sharing a meal. And especially back then, when you shared a meal with someone, it was a big deal in that custom. So he is saying, Levi, your family. And the sinners and the tax collectors are all sitting around. They're having a great time. And who gets upset? Yes, the Pharisees, the religious leaders of the time, like, what are you doing? See, guys, if you would have ate back then, you would have been then known as of one of them. And I love that not only does Jesus treat Levi like family, he then goes above that and chooses him, deems him worthy enough to be a disciple. Someone that the whole entire city probably deemed this man an outcast. He was hated, you know, all the... But Jesus literally is like, you're worthy, come follow me. It's so powerful, guys. We, a lot of times, think we have got to clean ourselves up. We've got to do X, Y, and Z. We need to go to school, learn the Bible. I don't know. We think we got to do all of these things. And Jesus is like, I just need your heart. Come follow me. But we, guys, catch. We, as a society, has deemed who's good enough. Who's worthy enough? And we've somehow put people in places that they're not supposed to be. And if we really studied the life of Jesus, guys, I have been studying Jesus' life more this past year than I probably ever have in my life. Jesus is awesome. I want to be like him. I am nowhere near him. I want to be like him so bad. He was so great at what he did. That's why his impact was so amazing. He was different. We got to be different. We got to be different. So see, guys, when you break through the societal stereotypes and you love the outcast like family, two things happen. Number one, write this down. Loving the outcast brings hope. And listen, guys, I'm not talking about the hope where you're like, I hope that I lose 20 pounds. I hope I do this. That's like wishful hoping, okay? So there's a difference in wishful hoping. Like, I hope this happens, whatever it is, right? That's wishful. That's not the hope I'm talking about. I'm talking about the hope that is the confident expectation of what God has promised, and it's the strength is in his faithfulness. That's the kind of hope I'm talking about. And hope is powerful. When you give someone hope, listen, I'm going to share this story with you. Recently, I was talking to another pastor, and she was talking about just this, loving an outcast. And so basically, she had come across a family who was homeless, and they were living in their car. What do? Instead of turning their other cheek, you know, grumbling some like, well, they have to have done something to get themselves in that position. They, you know, whatever people do, we always have a reason as to why we think those people are in that position, as if somehow we know their lives, right? It's just, why do we do that? But they didn't. They loved on this family. They came alongside this family. This family is now, not only are they not homeless, they are senior pastors at a church in Texas now, spreading the gospel like never before. Had someone written them off as they could have easily still be in that car instead of impacting hundreds and thousands of people in their community, right? Because someone gave them a little bit of hope, a little bit of love, a little bit of encouragement. Didn't treat them like an outcast. You never know, guys, because listen, hope ultimately changes lives. Love in the outcast, it will change their life. If you look at every story where Jesus came in and loved the person that was considered an outcast, they were never the same. They were never the same. They were healed, they were set free, they were changed. Whatever the case was, they never were the same. The whole trajectory of their life completely changed. So guys, when you step in and you love the outcast and you give them a little bit of hope, their whole lives will change. I guarantee you. I have seen it over and over. About a month ago, I have to watch because we are recording, so I'm going to try to tell this story as much as I can without giving names and details. But me and my husband and a few people went up to a church, and we were going to help them with an outreach that they were doing, and we were going to learn from them and study. And anyways, we went up there, and we were knocking on doors, and we were basically bringing the relief to these people. And so I came in, and we were to this particular family. They had built relationships. So it's been a year and a half of building relationships with these people, just like we're trying to do at our community we have adopted. And so I go in, and we gave diapers and some things, and I sat down, because you know me, listen, I just don't care. I get the older I get, you just don't care. And so I came in, and I sat down, and there was this big guy, and he had tattoos and piercings, and just super intimidating looking. But he opened his mouth. He was the biggest teddy bear. And he started sharing about what God's doing, and like he just got a job, and they're moving out of government housing, and he just went on and on and on and on about the faithfulness of God and the restoration, and he was amazing. And I was like, oh, cool. And I was listening to a story, and we prayed over them, and we left, and we got back to the church, to that pastor's church. And they were kind of debriefing the people that we hadn't, talked to that day. And so they talked about this particular family, because actually when we were there, I actually got a vision and got a word for them, and I shared that. And so we were talking about that, and I had no clue about their situation. And so the vision was spot on. But so they were telling me about the thing, and this guy actually was a murderer. This guy had been in a gang for many years. He got jumped out about a year ago, and he has done some things. I would have never known that about this guy had they not told me, because of the restoration power of Jesus Christ in his life. This guy is now, I would have never, ever, ever knew anything about that story based off of what I saw, because he was changed. Guys, when Jesus steps in, everything changes. Now he's the cameraman at their church. He is on fire. He's telling other people. He became a completely different person once God intervened. But a lot of people would have looked at him. If you would have sat down and you would have, if I encountered the man one way, and if we would have said another, like come out and said, okay, this guy's a murderer. He's a this. He's a stealer. He's done. You're right now in your brain, you're just thinking what you would have thought about this and what you would have thought about this. And that's where the problem is, guys. We should never look at someone, no matter what they've done, and think any differently of them. Because you never know. Jesus could come in, and that person is completely different. At the core of who I am, guys, I am all about restoration and healing in people's lives. And why? Because I'm going to share my story with you guys today. And it's real and it's raw and it's very authentic. And please, God, guys, just hold it with dear hearts. The reason why I'm so passionate is because I was an outcast. I was that person that people literally could walk past and spit on and think, she is nothing. She has ruined her life. See, guys, my story is I was raised and brought up by a teenager. My mom had a kid at 15 and she had me at 17. She was a high school dropout. My life story is I could write a book. I could be here all day, so I'm just going to give you the bullet points. But I grew up in a home back then, and it was full of drugs and drinking and teenagers trying to raise children. And so there was lots of sexual abuse that I've experienced. There's lots of physical abuse. There's neglect. There's abandonment. I mean, there's just stuff. And then when I got older, because I had a lot of issues that no one ever seemed to deal with, so I started making some really bad choices. So when I became a teenager, I started leaving the house and not coming back. And eventually at like probably age 14, I left. I was like, I'm out of here. I'm gone. So from 14 on, I was on the streets. I dropped out of high school. At one point, I landed myself in jail because I made some bad choices there. I landed myself pregnant as a teenager. So here I was, high school dropout, making some really bad choices, basically living on the streets, and now I'm pregnant. And a lot of people would have looked at that little girl and said, wow, she is, and they did. Listen, they did. Trust me. People treated me very badly because you're messed up. And they didn't look at me with any potential. They didn't look at me as if, you know, you're going to ever amount to anything. But you know who did look at me that way? Jesus. Someone took me to church. And for the first time in my life, I felt the unconditional love. And you guys don't know this about your pastors, but your pastors were one of the first people that looked at me in the middle of my mess and let me serve, took me to Africa. They didn't look at the fact that I had a kid. My little boy actually went with me to outreaches. They didn't say, wow, she is a mess. And I was. They didn't say, you know, she needs to stay over there. They said, you know what? You want to help? Sure. Come on. You want to serve? Sure. Come on. You guys don't know how amazing your pastors are, and I pray that you continue to know who they are. They are so amazing. They loved on me. Unconditionally. They didn't see me as an outcast. They saw me as a daughter of God. And through people like them and other people who poured into my life was restored. I eventually went back to high school, got a high school degree. I actually have a bachelor's degree. I'm the first person in my family to have ever have a degree in college. And so I'm like, woo, yes, I'm praying my children. That's why I'm like, y'all are going to college. you know, and I have an amazing husband. I married a pastor's kid. Like, God really just blessed me. And then I have amazing children, and now I'm standing on here today about to plant a church. What if someone would have just not believed in me? What if no one ever reached out to me? You know where I would be? I'd be dead. Just being honest. Most of my friends that I was running with back then, they're all dead or they're in prison. Not one of them are alive or not in prison. That'd have been me. Prison or dead. But someone didn't look at me like I was an outcast. They looked at me as a child of God, and they gave me a little bit of hope, and my whole life changed. How many people, Philip, you can come. How many people right here in Stanley County is an Angela? Right now. How many people have we written off because our own whatever? Do you know if we were to truly love like Jesus and love those people and show whoever you think those people are, if we truly were to love on them unconditionally, not saying, they didn't tell me I had to clean myself up. They just said, hey, come on. You know who cleaned me up? The Holy Spirit. It's not my job to clean anybody up. The Holy Spirit will do that. It's our job to reach out to those people. So I want to just encourage you guys, when you go out, this whole series is talking about loving your neighbor. It's so easy to do from the stage, and we can say, love your neighbor. But guys, like Michaela said, souls are going to hell because we have decided not to show the love of Christ. We have got to start loving the people in our community that no one else wants to love. That's what Jesus did. He loved on. He said, I did not come for I can't even think of a scripture, that he did not come for the well. He came for the sick. And we have to, as a church, and I know that this is my last Sunday, but I know this is also the heart of pastor. But here at this church, we have got to catch Jesus's heart. It's not catching Pastor Nate's heart. It's not catching my heart. This isn't coming from us. We're not just saying, can you just be like us? We're saying, be like Jesus. Can we catch Jesus's heart? And you know what I think will happen if you truly catch Jesus's heart? This place will be so full, you'll be running multiple services because people are just going to be flocking to Christians because they actually look like Christ. I want to challenge us to start looking like Christ to everyone, everyone. When you look at that person and you think you're instantly going to judge them as an outcast, I want you to remember my face and say, that little girl, that boy, that man, that whatever is an Angela. There is potential. There is hope. There is restoration. Because that's what Jesus sees. He just sees a son and daughter. So let's pray. God, first, we're going to repent. And if you want to repent with me, stand to your feet, and we're just going to say, God, we are sorry. We are sorry for not being what we need to be to all people at all times. So, God, we ask for your forgiveness. God, we ask for your forgiveness. A lot of times things happen once we ask for forgiveness, so we're here saying, forgive us. Forgive us. And I pray, God, that you would move so mightily in our hearts that we couldn't help but begin to love like you love and begin to see people like you see people. We want to be Jesus to the people in Stanley County. Help us. Show us. Guide us. Tell us how we need to walk this out. Because it's one thing for me to say it, God. Start giving us the wisdom on the how. So I was not planning on doing this, but I'm going to do it. Because Pastor will give you the how. I guarantee you. If you want to make a difference and truly love your neighbor, I'm going to ask you to step out. There's something about stepping out and saying, yep, that's me. Come to this altar right now. If you are saying no more with the religious things, no more with the spirit of the negativity, all the things, I truly want to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Come to this altar. And I believe the people at this altar, we will make a difference. Yes, Jesus. God, you see the hearts of these people, God. You see them saying, use me, Lord. They say, forgive me, and now they're saying, use me. Help me to know how to love when we don't know the right words to say. We don't know what we're supposed to do. I pray that you would intervene in that situation, that the Holy Spirit would guide them, that the direct them, that the Holy Spirit would just intervene in those moments. They wouldn't see that person, but they would see Jesus.
This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down. You are all I'm chasing. This is my surrender.
Yes, God, we truly surrender today, Lord. Yes, Jesus.
And I will make room
for yes,
you.
Lord. We
to
surrender those broken hearts, that bitterness
you.
That we've carried, Lord God. Whatever has hindered us from spreading love to the outcast, God, we give it to you today, Lord Jesus. We lay it at your feet so we can walk out and truly be your hands and feet, God.
To do whatever you want to, Jesus.
These things in your name. I pray that this just wouldn't be an emotional experience at the altar. I pray that we truly walk out of here different, that we truly are going to take the things that Pastor has preached over the last several weeks and truly go love our neighbors. Love our neighbors like you. Letting our flesh get out of the way, letting ourselves get out of the way, and just being you. So God, I thank you. I sense a mighty move that's going to happen through the AFA people. God, we thank you. Thank you, Jesus.
And amen. That was a powerful service, a powerful testimony. Thank you, Angela. We appreciate it so much. I hope you guys are just ready to change our county. I'm excited about it. I hope you are too. Before you go.